Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the next episode of our journey towards making generic components more universally usable. So it's kind of obsession of mine whenever I find a case where generic components, algorithms are not doing their job quite as I would like them to do, quite as one would expect. I try to find out how to make that better. And today on the table is our structures, data structures which are nested with internal structure. So like vector of vector or the likes. So we look into problems with that, and then we will look into the usual STL approach of dealing with that, which is making them flat, or at least look flat, and we will see how to do that and also some problems with that. And then I will present approach which is sort of the other way around, namely to somehow take that structure into account and somehow wrap the algorithm around the existing structure of the data. And when we have all our nice structure-aware algorithms, we can step back and see if we can use them even in contexts where we have a perfect flat sequence by artificially slicing that sequence into chunks. Okay, let's start with these nested structures. I've set up a small benchmark for you. Okay, it's a vector of 100,000 floats or ints in this, no, floats and a deck of 100,000 floats, and I simply sum up over the vectors, all the floats, and over the deck, all the floats. And, well, what's the difference in performance you would expect? Who expects there is virtually no difference? Okay. Who expects there's a difference of about 20, 30 or so percent? Okay. Who expects there's a difference of a considerable factor of 5 or so? Okay. Who expects there's an even larger difference? Okay. On this quite old model, the difference is rather exactly 4. And the question is, why this is. Anybody an idea why this is? Yeah?
Caches.
No caches here?
The data is continuous.
Yeah, it has to do with that, but I don't think caches are the problem here. Yeah?
Memory prefetch.
No, I don't think so. Because the memory, I mean, okay, depends how it is allocated, but you could have it even if it's virtually the same chunk of memory. Yeah?
Another option is vector.
But we will look.
See that, so it says SSD4.
Yeah, that's why it's only 4. If I had a more modern computer, it could be 8. But anyway, let's look into that later on, where we really see why this is, where it comes from. So if you look into DAC, we see it's essentially an array of pointers to other arrays. Pointers to fixed size arrays. That's the implementation of DAC. And this is called segmented data structure or nested data structure or hierarchical data structure. So it means, as you said, the data is not contiguous in one large chunk, but it is in chunks which may be somewhere in memory. Normally, they would be likely, if the DAC is allocated in one go as we did, would be rather close to each other, but it is not a problem here. And these chunks are called segments or extents. And examples, I mentioned it in the introduction, might be list of vector or vector of vector, or container of container. So if you nest containers, you get this type of structure. Well, they have this TC style pointer arrays or data structures which are optimized in some way, for instance, with padding to avoid fault sharing, multi-threading applications, or if we have a strongly heterogeneous hardware, you might choose to allocate parts of your data where it is handled, where it's computed, so near to the cores, and so on. And I expect these type of data structures to get more common in the future as the hardware gets more heterogeneous. Okay, in order to deal with that, some sequences are in order. So, a segmented sequence is a sequence of segments. So if you think now as a list of vector as a guarding example, the segments will be the vectors. and the sequence, the top-level sequence, the major sequence will be the list. And the segments, as I said, themselves are sequences, ranges, in this case the vector, and I will call them minor sequences because they sort at the lower level of the hierarchy. They again can be flat or they can again be segmented. So if a vector, a vector, a vector, we have three layers of hierarchy here. Okay. This doesn't work. I have to use my hands. And the whole thing, the whole sequence is a sort of logical construct which would result if I concatenate all the minor sequences one after the other. So in this case, if I have a list of vectors, if I just make a big vector with all the content of all vectors in one thing. I also call this a flattened sequence. This doesn't work anymore here.
Point to the laptop. Where's the receiver?
The receiver is here. Bad luck. Okay. And by extension, I call the major iterator, iterator of a top-level sequence, which is the list iterator in our example, and the minor iterator would an iterator over the small vectors. Okay, now we have essentially two problems or two questions. The first thing is, if I have a vector, a list of vector, how I can use an STL algorithm on that at all? I mean, for the DAC, it has already been implemented. Apparently, the iterator, but for others, we don't have such a flat view of that. So we need a flat view, so we need a flattening or flat iterator. And if we do that, if you see, there might be considerable performance differences. And the second question is then how to get efficient implementations of algorithms on these sequences. So somehow we must explore this hierarchical structure. And the first part I will deal with question one, and in the second part I deal with question two, and in the third part I will bring together both things. Okay, a bit of history is also in order. This issue was investigated, to my knowledge, first investigated by Matt Orson in a paper published in 89, and since then it doesn't seem to have deserved the attention, I think, which it merits. I think Matt Orson in his paper mentions he has a performance difference of 20% or so, which was obviously before the date of vectorization units. Okay, so this is the STL approach. Making flat what isn't. So everything must look flat, so otherwise we can't treat it with the STL algorithms. So we can define a flattening iterator, which sort of iterates over the logical whole sequence. And, well, it's rather straightforward. In a sense, we just have a pair, essentially, of a major iterator and a minor iterator. And if we move over the minor sequences until we reach the end, and then bump up the major iterator for the next sequence, and so on. So it's quite straightforward. And the value we are referencing is, of course, that of the minor, the low-level sequence. Okay, here's an outline, it's only pseudocode. I left out a lot of stuff here just to highlight the major points. And will be a common theme. I only show the necessary code normally and not the whole thing. There might even be syntactic incorrect statements on the code, so nothing to copy into your editor and compile. Okay, here we see it. We have the minor major iterator here. The increment is, as I said, we bump up the minor iterator and then if we're at the end of the current segment, we bump up also the major iterator. And equality is just comparing the pair, major and minor. Okay, so far so good. Okay, but there's one interesting design choice, at least one, or remarks, which is related to how to present the end of the whole thing, the end of the entire nested sequence. So if we call capital E underscore W, the end iterator of the major of the whole sequence, we have essentially three options. So if we call capital E the past the end of the major sequence, or it would be in our example list of vector, it would be the list end iterator, and PE is the previous one. So the last valid segment points to the last valid segment. So first choice is we use this last valid segment and some valid position within that segment. This is done by the DAC. So whenever a segment gets full, the last segment gets full, they just allocate a new one and points the end to the first element of that. At least this is a GCC implementation of the DAC. Okay. Second option, which is a bit more natural, perhaps, is to use the last valid segment and the end iterator, pass the end iterator of that. So it would be, in our case, the list iterator would point to the last vector, which is there, and we would have the end iterator of that vector as the end of the whole thing. And the third option would be to use the pass the end iterator of the major sequence, so the end iterator of the list. And then the minor iterator doesn't matter anymore, because when we are there, we are at the end. It makes no sense to have a value of the minor iterator. Okay, and the choice will affect, of course, all the basic operations. I will show that in a minute, how this will change. Remark that the first and second options will only be viable if we can access the last valid segment, which only works if we have at least a bidirectional iterator. In case of list, it will work. If we have a forward list or a singly linked list of a vector, it will not work anymore because we can't easily get the last one.
How about the major sequences?
There we have EE then. Yeah, in that case, you...
The second have a problem.
Yeah, then also they have a problem, indeed, yeah. Well, in the case of DAC, you will just have sort of, you could have the same minor iterator in both cases. It's also empty then. But you will be forced, of course, to have always at least one segment. Of course, that's clear, yeah? So, and that's what the DAC says. I always have at least one segment. Even if the DAC is empty, there will be some memory in it. Okay, so for these reasons, I choose for this talk to explore the third option, which is the most general, but it complicates a bit our code. Because always we have to check if we are at the end of the major sequence. So here I highlight in red the things we have to introduce. We also must know the pass the end iterator of the major sequence, and then, for instance, here if we bump up, we must check if we have arrived at the end, and only if not, we can then use the major iterator to assign the next minor iterator. Also clear. And same is for comparison. We must also check the case that we are at the end, and if we are at the end, we don't compare the minor iterator anymore because it's undefined. Okay, and there's another design point. The question is if we are at a pointing on a segment with a major iterator, how to access the beginning and end of that segment. It's very easy in the case we have a nested container because there's a standard way to access the beginning and end of a container. Just use M is an iterator then over the segments, over the vector in the case of list of vector, and we can just use the begin and end of that. Different problem is if we have a C type or C style double star. So we can, of course, point to the begin because just star M is the begin and star M plus some N is the end, but we don't know the N normally, except if we have constant or fixed size. So it's different, and it depends on the case whether we store that in an extra array or whatever. So it's not clear in general. So if you go for a generic solution, we must have extra parameters to encapsulate these details. So we can't derive it with traits like in the 1D case with a T star. We can make T star a valid STL iterator just by using a traits technique. It's not possible for T star star because we have this extra information we don't get by the type. Okay, but we won't follow that further here. Okay, so now is a very interesting topic, the category of such a flattening iterator, given the categories of the both minor and major iterator. So sort of clear that we can't, of course, be better than any of the individual iterators. If a list of vector, we can't be better than bidirectional. That's rather trivial. But more interesting is the case, let's say, if we have both random access iterators. So what is the category of that? Who thinks it's random access? Okay, only a few very courageous. Who thinks it's bidirectional? Okay. Anyway, who thinks it's even less than bidirectional? Who thinks it's something completely different? Oh, the rest doesn't think. Okay. Okay, I think also it's something different, but I will show who is right now. Okay, so we must check three essential operations for random access, what we and see if we can compute them in constant time. So one thing is arbitrary jumps of an iterator. The second one is the difference of two iterators, and the third one is the comparison of two iterators. Okay, let's look in detail. Okay, advance an iterator. So, okay, we have iterator major minor sitting somewhere in some sequence and run through for 10,000, n is 10,000, we want to go 10,000 elements further. So if that is in the local sequence still, we are done. If not, we have to go to the next sequence, see how big it is, and if it's not big enough, it goes to the next, and to the next, and the next, and so it's clear that it's linear in a number of segments. Okay? So only if we know that each segment has a fixed size, then we can compute that. So if it's a DEC case, we can have random access or constant time in this case. And if we are very clever and pre-compute the sizes of the sequences and put that in a prefix sum and then use some clever searching, we would also be able to reduce that, but it's very unclear how to store that, where to store this information. So, question mark, if we can do that in general. Difference is the same story, essentially, because we also have to go through all sequences or all segments in the middle to find out the actual distance. So again, if we know the sizes before, we can do it in constant time. And finally, the comparison. This is a bit better because we know the segments and we can decide, because the segments are also random access, we can sort the ordering on the segments. And if we have solved that or are in the same segments, we can use the ordering on the inside the segments, in the segment. This is a minor iterator. So in this case, it's okay. So basically, those of you who said bidirectional have won because formally it's bidirectional. But I will argue also I'm right when saying it's not, it's something in between because it's much better than usual bidirectional. So one of the three things we can compute in constant time is the others are normally much faster than linear time, which would be the bidirectional case. Yeah. So if we have a sort of square layout, like the whole thing is capital N, then we have square root of N sequences, so we would get something like O, something in the order of square root N. So it's much better than a linear case. So in any case, if we have such threatening iterators, we must absolutely provide custom implementations for both advance and distance to catch that additional possibility or the performance that is there, the opportunity for additional performance. Otherwise, we will end up with generic implementations which will be linear, which is not good. Okay. Yeah. Okay, now back to our benchmark. Yeah, we have seen the vector code is 4 times faster than DEC, and now we look at the code which is generated. I have here a very innocent template for reduce. And here we have, I've highlighted in red the iterator operations, which don't look very dangerous at the moment. But if you plug in what we saw, it looks like this. And I think that's a good job for Chandler to try to optimize that. And I guess it will not work, at least not with currently. So it gets a bit better if we have another option for representing the end iterator, but still it doesn't work. Isn't enough, as we have seen for the DEC case, which chooses the most, the simplest option for the end iterator. So this means there are two issues here. First, of course, we have to do more than incrementing an iterator. That's one thing. I think this is something which contributes to the 30% that might also observe, but it's what more important is that we can't vectorize this code because of all these checks. So no compiler currently, I think, will vectorize that. So, but we really, if we would hand code that, what would we do? We would write two loops, of course, yeah? One outer loop and one inner loop here. And this, of course, will vectorize. And we can use inside, we have access to the original iterators, which are full random access, and we can do everything we want with them. Always choose the most efficient implementation. Okay, so you can think about why this example is simplified a bit, but I will go on to the next section. Okay, so you see, we must somehow find a way to achieve this structure awareness, which lies here in the double loop, also for generic algorithms. So there must be some way to reuse that information, which is somehow implicitly already present in our flattening iterator, because it knows about the structure. It uses the structure to implement its basic functionality. We must somehow have a way to extract that and map it into our algorithm. So we must retrieve the structure, and so that it means that we must go from a purely flattening iterator, which has the knowledge but hides it from us, to something which exposes this knowledge to us, and then we can use it in the algorithm. So on this, I call it structure-aware iterator or segmented iterator, as Austin has called it, or maybe also hierarchical iterator. And it's not really that difficult. If you look back to our example, we see that what we need is, of course, we need types to represent the major minor iterators. We need to know in which segment we are. We need to, for each segment, we need to produce the begin and end, of course. And if we start with a minor iterator, such a hierarchical iterator, and end with such a hierarchical iterator, we must be able to also find out where they point to in their current sequences. So because the begin iterator might be something which points into the middle of a sequence, and the end iterator also might be something that points into the middle of a sequence. Okay, and I choose to implement that directly on top of a flattening iterator, because it's a class anyway. We need a class anyway to represent a flattening iterator, and don't see any argument not to also provide this information in the same class normally. So we will just extend that and arrive here. I just show the additional functionality here, some type defs. We get the position in the current. It gets a current segment and the position in this current segment. And also we can move to the next segment, which is logically just plus plus m. I have an extra functionality here because it's more general. In some cases, you can't use plus plus m. We come back later to that. Okay. So this will give us the whole information we need, and our accumulate, if we make it more general, we must then handle, as I said, following parts of the sequence. First, the first segment, which might be incomplete, then the middle segments, which are complete, and the end segment, which is also possibly incomplete. Okay, and this makes the whole code a bit complex. Complicated, not really complex, but complicated. Our goal is to maintain a common interface for both flat and structure-aware iterators. So have one common entry point, and depending on whether the iterator is indeed flat or not, it will branch to a flat version or to a hierarchical version. And by extension, because it will be recursively calling the high-level version, we will also be able to deal with arbitrary deep nesting. So if we have vector of deck or vector of something, we will be able to handle that, provided we do the painful job of defining the flattening iterators. Okay, here's the top-level code. So we have our top-level accumulate, which essentially implements a branching depending on some very simple type traits on the iterator. This branches according to whether the iterator supports a hierarchical interface or is just a normal iterator. And if we are in the hierarchical case, we call a hierarchical version, and otherwise we call just the flat version. And now we look at the hierarchical version, which is the most interesting. Here we are. Okay, let's look, go straight here. Here are some previous preliminary definitions. We extract the iterators we need and okay, check if we are already at the end, and then we handle the first segment and call the accumulate on that and store the partial result in the init variable. Then we have handled the first incomplete segment, and then we go to the next segments. We loop over the segments and always put in the init argument into our accumulate to handle segments step by step. And then we do the last segment. So we pipe the partial results through this variable here. So it's basically rather simple, only a bit complicated because of these three types of segments we have, but not really rocket science. Okay, now we can test it. Let's look if it performs better than the usual algorithm. So what I did is use a rather recent version of GCC and turned auto-vectorization on and tested two different lengths of segments, where the first one is the value used in the DAC implementation on the GCC, and the other one is a bit larger. And we see here, so as baseline, I just used a flat C array as reference, normalized to 1. And we see then, here's the case I reported, the DAC is 4 times slower than the flat vector, and if I use vector-vector, it has exactly the same performance as the DAC. Okay. Even the overhead is slightly higher because my implementation of the flattening iterator is slightly less efficient than the DAC one, but it doesn't really matter here. Okay, and if I use a hierarchical version here, vector or vector flow is hierarchical iterator, then in the case of the small segments, there is still some overhead, but it's much less than the flat one. And if I make the chunk sizes sufficiently large, then I have no overhead anymore. Great. Okay, so this works in principle. Now, problem is it works for one algorithm, and we have so many. Yeah? Do we have to do that for 100 algorithms in the SDR, for instance? So question is if we somehow can do it at once for several algorithms. So if you look here, it's incomplete, it's not all algorithms, so. But we have already seen in a recent talk that, for instance, we can implement count or countif in terms of accumulate, and max element here is also something which is reduction, so there's some chance to reuse the same pattern again. So idea is, can we find groups or identify groups of algorithms which have that same pattern, and we can use the same meter algorithm to implement them in a hierarchical way. Okay, first we have already seen the reduced type, which we'll look at a bit more in detail. Then they have the other types like transform, which is changing each value, like fill or transform, or for each does not even change the value, but just does something based on the value. Then we have find or linear find type, like all of or find and so on, a lot of other functions. I will also look into that a bit. Then we have more complicated things which move things around rather arbitrary within the sequence, also between segments, which I won't look at here because it's much more complicated. I think it needs special approaches each. I think so. Okay, and then there are some technical complications. So if algorithms take more than one range, okay, if you really want to drive the argument to the end, you would have to match the segmentations, and it gets complicated, not unsolvable, but it gets much more complicated. We will only look a very bit on that case here. We look at the simple cases first. Okay, so if you want to see how we can handle all of these reduced type algorithms, we must find a common pattern or sort of streamline the interface of these algorithms and also look at some semantic properties. So a piecewise stepwise computation. So first, the interface, we can reorder the interface to start with a, let's say, a visual initial value, which I call init or R0, and then we have the range R, which is begin-end. It's also a standard range, standard STL range, and possibly a number of other arguments like operators or predicates or what you have, which are not interesting in our case for the general pattern, just have to be piped through the whole thing unchanged. Okay, and the important thing is that we can compose these algorithms. So we can split our range into two parts, start with the first range, compute results from the first range, and pipe that result as an initial argument in the computation of the second range. And this enables, let's say, the pattern we have seen before. We first compute the sum of the first part and pipe that as init argument into the sum of the second part. And this works for all the other algorithms as well. Okay, so they don't fit strictly, but we can wrap them to make them fit without big problems. So for instance, this STD accumulate has the init argument as third, we move it to the front. The count has no init argument, we can just add one and add that to the result if you want. No big deal. And even if you look at transform type algorithms, they don't seem to fit at first sight, but we can add, let's say, take fill, we can add a dummy init argument, which is just ignored, and same interface. So we can also handle the transform type algorithms with the same meta algorithm. Yeah?
So I missed why you ordered the arguments. Why did you have to move it?
Because we want, we need, okay, I go back here. I go back a number of slides here. Look here. So this was specific for accumulate. And I want this to work with accumulate replaced by other algorithms. So they must match the interface. Okay, here I have just used the standard interface of accumulate, but now I must fix a common interface for all algorithms of that group. And just fixed arbitrarily to have first the init argument, second the range, and then others, like here the operator, which I will just pipe through. Yeah, I will make this a parameter, again, another parameter of my meta algorithm, and then I must stick to a certain interface. And so I must have init arguments everywhere, even if I don't need them. Okay. Okay, we were here. So we can fit a lot of algorithms to that pattern. Okay, here's an example how we wrap count. We just add this init argument here. I think it should actually be operator function call instead of f, but anyway. And, well, quite simple, we just add init to the std count. No big deal. Okay, one technical note, if we return iterators, like in find, for instance, or in max element, we return iterator to a sequence, it gets more involved because we need then also to return iterator on the top level, and we must somehow build an hierarchical iterator from the level iterators, which is essentially a technical problem. I did not completely solve this, but it's not, I think, a principal problem, just a technical problem to overcome. But here we just return numbers, which is same on each level. So no problem here. Okay, now let's look into the generic implementation, which I won't show in full, but only that you get the idea. That's the same logic. We have a top-level algorithm which branches into a flat and a hierarchical version and takes additional argument. Of course, it takes the same arguments as before, the init argument and the range, but also takes our algorithm f plus any other arguments. And this point is where variadic templates come in and shine, of course. Otherwise, it would be very difficult to do in a general way. Okay, here we have our top level reduction algorithm, takes additionally this algorithm. So reduce or the accumulate or count or what, or a wrapped one, it will take a wrapped algorithm which has this standard interface we just defined, and any number of other algorithms. Okay, in the flat one version just calls f with the arguments, and I should likely use std forward here, but I removed, left that out for conciseness reasons. And in the hierarchical version, I will have a hierarchical implementation, which is very similar to what we saw before for the special case of accumulate. We essentially replace accumulate by f and have other algorithms piped through that call. Otherwise, they are not really, it's not really a change. Okay, so if we want now define a hierarchical count, it's just a wrapper around our generic reaction type algorithm. We just plug in or pass a wrapped count or a wrapped count. And if you want to do the same with accumulate, we just pass the wrapped accumulate. And we are done for that case, for this group of algorithms. And we can test, I tested it, it gives the same performance result. So there's no performance drawback. Okay. How many times? Still a bit. So we can, so we have done the reduced group of algorithms, reduce and transform group. So it's quite, I think, perhaps 10 algorithms at once. Good, and we can look at some other algorithms to see if we can do the same. Okay, I already talked about fine type. I will go into that a bit later. Then we have copy, which is a special case. It's, well, copy is not a demanding algorithm, but we want to use our low-level primitives like memcopy and so on, and we certainly can't do that on a standard flattening iterator, which is not random access. Even random access does not suffice. It must be contiguous memory. Then binary search is a very interesting example because it requires random access for optimal performance. I already talked about these primitives, which need a special implementation. And well, for sorting, I won't go into the details, but just remark that std sort won't be applicable to our vector-vector example because it requires standard requires a random access iterator, so it won't just won't compile. So if you want to do sorting for these things without copying first, we would have to use some pattern which is likely very similar to what is used in external sort or something. But I won't go in, I have not gone into details here, but it needs a special implementation for sure. Okay, binary search. You have seen these flattening iterators are not normally random access, and we need random access for logarithmic behavior of binary search, which also requires, of course, sorted sequence. And so we need a hierarchical version of that, which is also quite simple. So first we search the right segment, and then we search the right position within the segment. So 2 times log n, total also log n. Okay. And this is, I think, example which not just a factor of 4 or 8, but it's a really difference in complex asymptotic complexity. So I said that. Okay, then we can go to find. So what's the feature of find? Like in the reduced case, we just scan the sequence one by one and evaluate a predicate on each element. And then there comes a difference. The difference is if we find something which satisfies the predicate, we return that. Find will return the first element which matches. So, and we call this a success. So I think it's a definition of success everybody will subscribe to. If we have success, we can go home early. Yeah? And even better, we can check from the result whether we had a success. So, for instance, in the algorithm is all off, the success case is if we find a counter example. So if all off returns false, we had a success because we could return early. If it's true, we had to go until the end of the whole thing. Okay, so let's look at some examples. I think it's mostly even all examples I could find. So of course the find and colleagues here, then the Boolean versions, just checking Boolean predicate. Then potentially things like equal, who that this compare two sequences. It will work in the normal version only if the two sequences are, let's say, segmented the same way. So if one is segmented and the other is not segmented, it's okay, and if they are segmented in the same structure, then it will work, because then logically we can treat it as one sequence which consists of pairs of values, and we just compare the value and then have the other back in the normal regime. Okay, then this partition is a very interesting case, because we have to more or less change it. Let's say it looks for a partition point, and everything before the point must satisfy the predicate, and everything after the point must satisfy the inverse of the predicate, the negation. So we must do something in the wrapper, but it can also be done. And, find first off, we check if any of this SB, SE sequence is inside our main sequence. And if we consider the second sequence as being small and part of the predicate, we can also think it's just the variant of find. Okay. Unfortunately, there are some cases where it doesn't work so well. So let's take is sorted. What we do here, we have to compare two adjacent positions, which is not a problem inside a segment, but if we go from one segment to the other, we would have to find the last one with the first one of the other, and it doesn't fit our generic algorithm, so we would have need a different one for that case. So it doesn't fit. And similar for search, which is even longer chunks need to be compared, so it doesn't fit. Okay, but still the list is good enough, I think. So I won't go into the details of the implementation, just a number of the wrapper. So I think it's essentially a generalization of the reduced type meta algorithm, just with the addition that it returns early if there is success. So the wrappers also must provide a standard way to check for the results, for success, so we know when we can go home. And even reduced type algorithms, we can implement that interface. We also can add a check for success, and it just returns false. That's never successful. They have to go until the end. So reduced type have to do the full job. So this is it should read false here. Yeah? Error here on my slide. Okay, so that's a simple wrapper here. I added an extra type for the return value, and it has two member functions. One to check the success, and one to get the actual result. And so you can use that in the meta algorithm to check if we are ready and can go home. Okay, that was for find. And for copy, it's also interesting because it's not a complicated algorithm, but we want to be able to use the fast primitives like memcopy. And for that also we need not only random access, as I said, we need contiguous access iterators. I think this is a category which will be introduced in C++ 17, if I'm correct. But at the moment there is no real way to check it. Well, okay, it's likely restricted standard pointers, mostly. Okay, so it's not an option for flattening iterator, which is not even random access, much less than contiguous access. Okay, but if we use a hierarchical copy and have contiguous segments, we can use also these primitives. And if only the input is segmented, we could try even to reuse the reduced type meta algorithm with some fiddling here. There are some complications if both input and output ranges are segmented, because then we have to match the segments and sort of make the intersections of the segments to arrive here. That's not easy, but doable, I think. And well, if it's really in the special case that the input iterator is not random access, we have a problem here with the standard implementation of copy, because we have a problem to look where we have to start in the next segment, because we would then the output iterator would prescribe us the end, how far we can go. So we would likely use then something like copy n. We must copy the n elements. It's prescribed by the output segments. And this does not return the input iterator where we end. And so we don't know how to go there, or we would have to advance by n steps, which is not efficient. So of course, you could wrap around it. But I think it's a deficiency in the interface of stdcopyn, which I think is shared by all underscore n, all counted variants. Anyway, we could work around by providing our own copy wrapper. It doesn't work, so we must not use, if we use stdcopy at the bottom, if the input iterator is not a random access, the bottom one. Anyway, that's a very technical thing here. The message to take home is that in the case of random access bottom, we can use fast versions, also with copy. Okay, so this was for the various possibilities to implement hierarchical algorithms. I think there's certainly more work to do. As I said, short, I did not touch upon. It's not so short and trivial, certainly, as the things we have seen. But now we can look on these things from the other side. So we have all these nice hierarchical algorithms now. And now we can try to use them also on perfect flat sequences by introducing artificial segments on them, logical segments. So why would we do that? So one idea is to plug in extra work at some specific points or terminate at some points, but we don't want to check each iteration, which is much too costly. It will destroy performance completely. So we'll check only every 10,000, 100,000, and so on, depending on the case. Or we might try to handle chunks of results to the next stage if we are in a pipeline, or even have some kind of lazy evaluation if the algorithms later on say we don't need any more. Or we could cut work into chunks for parallel computation or to reorganize our computation completely. So a lot of ideas I have here. I will look into some of them in more detail. So let's see, for the first one, to have some extra work at specific points. Oh yeah, so these are the options we have with hierarchical algorithms, and essentially there are two ideas or how one could implement that. First thing is to change the iterator to perform some extra work at specific steps. Or the other one is to, change the algorithm, add extra arguments, which we can always do. And the nice thing about the first option, which I will explore here, is that we don't need to change our very painfully created hierarchical algorithms. We can just use them, just change the iterator. Okay, first thing I will tell you how to get from a flat sequence, a chunked sequence, a logical chunked sequence. I introduced chunking iterator for that, which is basically has the same behavior as a segmented iterator, just it computes everything on the fly. So it gets, if it gets is set up with a fixed chunk size, it can even be a random access as a flat iterator, and it will forward all flat operations to the base type, which then means it can be used for standard algorithms without any overhead. But of course, we are interested in this in the hierarchical part of the interface. So this would look like that. It's very similar, only we have an additional parameter here, which is called chunk size, and we use that to compute all the functionality here. I don't go into detail. I think it's pretty straightforward how to do that. Okay, so first, simple example. Maybe we have a very long learning algorithm. We want to print out notifications, how far we are, or notify other parts of the problem how far we are. And what we do is each iteration, if we check each iteration, if we should print something, it's much too costly. So we check every nth iteration, and a way to do that is to instrument our iterator with something called observer, which looks if a certain event is there and then does something. So we can reuse our hierarchical algorithm, and we will make it such that the work only occurs at the boundaries of a segment, so in a sort of outer loop, if it will be hand-coded. Yeah? So it's then efficient enough. And it's a very, very simple example of something called algorithm animation, very basic example. So Okay, here's the instrumentation of the chunking iterator. We just have this extra parameter observer, and every time we bump up the segment, we do something with the give a notification to the observer, something happened. We get the next segment with that and that size. Okay. And then, well, here's a very stupid implementation of such an example of such an observer. Java just prints each time I handled such and such of such and such. So and so many. Could also set a global counter or something which other process could observe or whatever. Could do whatever here. Okay, and if you look at our code, I here annotated the places where this observer is called. It's always called where we go to the next segment. And only here, some action results. And this will be more efficient. Well, let's say this will be more efficient than checking each time, which also, of course, you could do in a normal algorithm, checking each time whether you should do something. But still, I think printing is so expensive that before my benchmark, it would still destroy. It would be better than the pure deck example if I make chunks very, very large, but it's still very costly. So, or put the other way around, summation is so cheap on a today's processor that outputting some numbers is so much more costly that it's hard to come up with a convincing benchmark of that, actually. Okay. Okay, I go to the, well, still a bit of time, to the next next one here. So let's see, again, we have a long running algorithm, and we just want to stop it if it's running too long, but not in some real-time environment or whatever. Well, we have some other algorithm running which also has computed results. And the same, we also instrument our iterator again, can also, could reuse an existing hierarchical version. And this would work by somehow replacing the comparison to the end iterator with something specialized, which checks for the end condition and then just pretends it's at the end if the condition is true and jumps out of the algorithm. So you could imagine by analogies similar use cases if you have poly algorithms, so different algorithms which compete for computing a result, and you don't know which one is the fastest. One classical example is linear iteration algorithms. You don't know if they converge. And so you would try push every algorithm a bit, and then the next one has to take over and so on. This could be one application of that idea. Other thing could be just to compute until your solution is good enough, but this would not really fit that style because you would also to pass the actual the current solution to the iterator, which is not in the current implementation. However, it could be changed to do so if we think that's useful. Okay, here is, so I did not highlight this. Here's the first, the forged comparison. So we need a special type to represent the end of the sequence. And then if you compare to the AND iterator, we just first check the flag. If there's a flag set, that we are at the end. And otherwise, if you compare with a normal pair, normal other iterator, we just do the normal thing. Okay, the timer just checks if a certain time has elapsed. Very simple. This would be our event listener. So it's called then again if we check the end of a segment. Okay, and this time we must, if we call the, we must change the algorithm because we have to introduce an extra type for the end iterator here, which is our new end type, which we must use to force a comparison here to trigger this check for the event. It's a bit contrived, the example. So this is a border case. I think one could consider also introducing an extra argument to the algorithm, and because one needs to change anyway the bit the algorithm. So open to discussion, of course, what's best here.
Well, the, uh,
special types for end iterators are part of the range proposal.
Okay, yeah.
For C++
sentinels. Yeah, yeah. Because they are useful in other contexts, like C strings. You don't have an end iterator. Okay, yeah. So it would fit that pattern then.
Yeah.
So you would likely normally anyway use a different type. That's it.
Exactly.
That's a quintessence. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and here I am marked in green where all these checks occur. So only at the boundary between two segments. Okay, yeah, then let's go to the more or less last example I want to bring you, which is about parallel programming. So if you have data parallel algorithm, we must provide them a partition of our data in order to have defined the tasks they should operate on. So, and chunking iterators could provide such a data partitioning. I mean, the chunking iterator I present is very static. You have a static distribution, but could also think of on recursive chunking, just bisecting the sec sequence and doing this recursively until some condition is met. So that these could also be piped into our hierarchical algorithms with some extra checks, because it's a runtime check whether it's hierarchical or not. But anyway, these are, I think, details. The pattern for these power meter algorithms is very similar to, if we applied on reduce type algorithms, very similar to what we have seen. The basic structure, but of course we have to make sure that the individual calls are occurring in parallel, and we have to somehow have a way to compute the partial results at the end only, not to introduce any artificial sequentialization here. So spanning the calls in a concurrent or parallel way, I think it should be normally done by the meter algorithm itself. It could also be part of the wrapper, but then it means it would only occur at the basic level, because otherwise it will go through the hierarchy until we're at the bottom, and only then a parallel call would occur, which is not ideal. Okay, so I think it would be interesting to see if its executors come, how to do this with executors, which I think are the best way to do that, because they will keep track of all algorithms requesting things to execute in parallel. So, and the combination of these results also must, this know-how or the semantics of the combination must also come from the wrapper. They must provide us combinators and must also provide the right init values, because we can't start from the last value, of course, because this would essentially mean the sequentialized, because we have to wait. So we must start fresh from a fresh init value, so it means we must use some neutral element of the algorithm, and this must be defined by the algorithm itself, of course. Who else should know that? Okay, so, and the combinator might be the algorithm itself, like in the case of accumulate, we just add up everything, or in case of count, we also add up, and so it's not, do not just count, so it's different there. Okay, I won't go into details of that, it gets a bit technical. I think the groups for the applicable groups for the parallel meter algorithms get a bit more narrow than in the sequential case, because in this case we do not just need composability, but we must be able to split the ranges and start freshly. And then it means essentially associativity of the algorithm. So I will skip over that, it's a bit technical, but yeah. Okay, and the wrapper looks then a bit more complicated, because then we must offer something to combine values and something, a method to access this neutral element, you know, if we want to have that in a generic way, and likely we need to extend it also with somewhere we must deal with this, not with bare values, but with something which is computed only in the future, with futures or something. It's not, well, I have not filled out the complete details, so either it could be, perhaps it could be done only in the parallel wrapper, in the parallel meter algorithm, or maybe it has to be somehow put here. It's not yet clear how to do it best. Okay, so I come really to the conclusion. So I hope I showed that you would have substantial gains by having specialized algorithms for certain cases. In this case, these segmented data structures, and also that perhaps the categorization of the SDL is perhaps not the last word, because there is something in between, for instance, random access and bidirectional iterators. And there's a long list of future interesting steps I could take. I won't go through that, and if you ask me tomorrow, I will have a different list likely. So there's lots of very interesting things one could look into. So lastly, I have a message from the very end of a deeply nested sequence. Thank you. There's a I think there's a microphone here.
I have the impression that when I was reading your accumulated code of the hierarchical algorithm, that it works as shown for an arbitrary number of segmenting levels.
Yes.
If you recurse on the minor iterator, is that right?
Yes, yes. If you, yeah. If you exactly, if you want to have an iterator, a flat iterator, and segmented iterator for a deeper nested sequence, then the second, the minor iterator, will cover the whole, the rest of the sequence. So the major is the top level, and the rest is then the rest.
Is that the case in general?
I think for
those hierarchical algorithms.
Well, at least for the things I've presented, I think yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It should be the case. Because in each layer of the hierarchical algorithm, you strip off one layer of your nesting, essentially. That's how it works.
I just wanted to say, you said that STD sort requires random access iterators, and I think that's just over constrained in the standard, because it's perfectly possible to make an in-place n log n sort with bidirectional iterators. And the partition, even in the standard, the partition algorithm only requires bidirectional iterators.
I think you're right, yeah. There are certainly algorithms which don't require random access.
Is there a possible to do it even with unidirectional iterator?
Possibly. I'm not an expert on sort algorithms, so.
So can you use your flattening iterator? Could I just immediately use that on any STL iterator? Because, I mean, you could sort of, with the iterator like traits, you could sort of probe if that iterator has itself an iterator type, and then someone with template metaprogramming figure out how deeply it's nested.
You mean if you want to parameterize such a flattening iterator with a, let's say, nested container or something.
Exactly. Yeah,
that would
just
be
like a very generic flattening iterator that takes any STL iterator and figures out like how deeply it's nested.
I think it would be an interesting idea. I thought about it, but not to the end of the nesting in a sense. So, so I think it could be done. Yeah, but you must. I had also one example in mind where you should be careful. So, for instance, if you have a fixed sized vector, a fixed sized array like 3 elements, which could be also treated as a container with begin end, but you also want to have it as a 3D vector, and you want to sum up a vector of those. Then the question is it a nested sequence, or do you want to treat this fixed size vector as a bottom value type? You must be able to distinguish these cases somehow. That's an important distinction. The user must do. It's not you can't automate it fully, I think.
I'd like to know because I'm not sure from following the talk if the hierarchical iterators that you the way you implemented them do they work with standard algorithms? So in theory, I think you could make it so that they have the same interface. So the thought is that if you have a data structure that provides hierarchical iterators, it would still be nice if it fell back on standard algorithms for the things that you haven't wrapped.
Designed in principle to do so. I mean, I have not a complete hierarchical library, so I think I tested it with simple algorithms, but that's not a guarantee that it always works. So I don't think I fully implemented iterator traits, for instance. Just make a rather concentrated approach towards this, what I needed here. But I think it's not a problem in principle to implement the full interface required for standard algorithms. I don't see any problem with that.
Except the category.
Well, I didn't implement it. It's also not a problem. I mean, the category is, of course, you need to be honest, of course, and you can only be bidirectional then. Yeah, and if you need more performance, you need to use a hierarchical version. I mean, that's not a problem. If you have the hierarchical algorithms, at some point, you will automatically use them with this mechanism. So.
The thing I'm not sure about is that if you have, if the algorithms,
so if the iterators have basically both interfaces, yes. So the flat and the hierarchical one, and you have both algorithm implementations, I'm not sure if it would easily be possible to automatically pick the right one.
Yeah, this is, I think that's not a big problem because you can have a static, this is traits I've briefly showed, which branches just takes, let's say, a Boolean value to each type, whether it has this hierarchical interface, and if it has, it will use a hierarchical version of the algorithm.
I understand that, but that still requires you to write this little dispatcher for every algorithm that you want to use, right?
That's true, yeah.
That's just, I was just thinking if there was a way to get around that.
Maybe, but I think these wrappers are rather trivial compared to the rest, so you could afford it, I think. You could, of course, write a meter algorithm to dispatch. I don't know if it's worth the effort. Okay, I think we are done. No questions anymore. I think we can do the rest in the break.